Let's go to God in prayer. Father God, we just thank you so much for gathering all of us together, Father God, that we can worship you and praise you and give you glory. Thank you, Father God, for always keeping us in good health. Thank you for the eyes that sees, Father God, your glory. Thank you for all that you do. We pray all this, Father, in your Son's name, Jesus Christ. And everyone say,
Amen.
Praise
Amen.
The Lord.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Amazing love. Here we go.
We were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Spirit is within me. Because of you, I died and rose again. I'm forgiven. Because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. I'm alive and well, Spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. Amazing love.
Savior, Lord, I give you my heart. desire.
This is my desire. To honor you, Lord, with all my heart, I worship you.
So glad you're here. If you're ready to get in the Word of God, I know the Holy Spirit will speak life into you no matter what you're going through in life. God knows about it. So, hey, why worry? Why fret about it? Just simply say, Lord, it is all yours. And God, He knows your heart. If He knows you truly belong to Him, yeah, He will take care of whatever problem you may have in your life. Amen. Praise God. Why don't we go ahead? Let's start off with a word of prayer. Let's come before our Father in heaven. Let's pray. Father God, we just want to thank you, Lord, for this time, as we know our minds and hearts truly belong to you. And I pray, Lord, whatever the enemy will try to do to steal our joy, we rebuke him in the name of Jesus Christ. And I pray that your peace will come, your love will come, your joy will come, and just fill our minds, our souls, and our spirits as we come fully surrendered and submitted to you. Father, we just want to tell you how much we love you and how much we praise you. It's in the name of Jesus Christ. We pray all of these things, and we all say together, amen. Praise God and praise God. Well, if you take a look at your notes, today the title of the sermon is The Devastating Power of the what? Of the locust. Can someone tell me what a locust is? Yeah, it's kind of like a grasshopper, but you know what? They're bigger and they're uglier. And I got to tell you, they are considered to be a farmer's worst nightmare. And you could say they are the farmer's worst enemy too. Because what does the locust do? They eat up everything in sight, right? And the fact of the matter is, you know, I mean, whether it be trees, shrubs, crops, when a swarm of them come and attack, right? Everything is wiped out. And it's not a pretty sight. And in the Bible, all right, whenever God had to send a swarm of locusts to a particular group of people, it was either a form of punishment for the wicked unbeliever or a means of discipline for those God considered to be his children. And we know when, you know, you find out that a swarm of locusts have attacked, you know, like a certain city. Yeah. Within like days, I mean, everything would be just wiped out. And regardless of the reason, right, when the swarm of locusts do come, right, everything in sight is just like, just stripped. You realize, man, these locusts, when they're hungry, they don't hold back, okay? They take everything, they eat everything, and destroy everything in sight. And you know, one of the worst cases of this happening in the Bible is in the book of Genesis, and this is when Moses and Aaron met up with Pharaoh. You guys remember this? Let's look in your notes here in Exodus chapter 10, okay? I want you to go ahead and read that with me. Ready? Go. So Moses and Aaron went to Pharaoh and said, "This is what the Lord, the God of Hebrew, says. How long will you refuse to submit to me? Let my people go so they can worship me. And if you refuse, watch out, for tomorrow I'll bring a what? A swarm of locusts on your country, and they will cover the land so that you won't be able to see the ground. They will devour what little is left of your crops after the hailstorm, including all the trees growing in the fields. They will overrun your palaces and the homes of your officials and all the houses in Egypt. Never in the history of Egypt have your ancestors seen a plague like this one." And with that, Moses turned and left Pharaoh. And so in this case, right, God, he sent the swarm of locusts to Egypt. Why? Because of Pharaoh's stubbornness, okay? He didn't want to let God's people go. And Moses and Aaron made it very clear, you ain't going to do it. Well, the plagues are coming. And this is one of the plagues, okay, that was sent by God. And you got to understand something here. God, he doesn't find joy in bringing any form of destruction in a person's life. Because sometimes I hear this, right? Sometimes people say, "Hey, Pastor Ben, I think God, he doesn't like me. And that's why, you know, I think he's making all these terrible things happen in my life." I go, "Why are you blaming God? You know, God, if he knows your heart belongs to him, he wants to bless your life. He wants his goodness to come forth in your life." So when you say something like that, it shows that you've been deceived. The devil's been trying to confuse you. He's trying to tell you, yeah, that God is responsible for this, when no, he isn't. And you know for a fact, and actually when, you know, God has to let these destruction come forth in a person's life, how do you think he feels? Do you think he's happy about it? Do you think he's like going, "Yeah, they deserve it. Yeah, I'm going to make it even worse to them"? No. You got to understand, God is grieved. I'm going to show this to you. Look what it says here in Genesis chapter 6, verses 5 to 7. And you guys remember the flood that God had to bring forth, okay? It wasn't locusts. You know, this time it was the flood. And this is what it tells us in Genesis chapter 6, verses 5 through 7. I want you to look at that. I want you to read it with me. Ready? Go. The Lord observed the extent of human wickedness on the earth, and he saw that everything they thought or imagined was consistently and what? And totally evil. So the Lord was very sorry he had ever made them and put them on the earth. Look what it says there. It what? It broke his heart. And the Lord says, I will wipe this human race I have created from the face of the earth. Yes, and I will destroy every living thing, all the people, the large animals, the small animals that scurry along the ground, and even the birds of the sky. I'm sorry that I have ever made them. Wow, when you hear something like that, it sounds kind of depressing, you know? But the fact of the matter is, because God had given man free will, right? That means he doesn't put like a computer brain in this person's head and make them think, you know, what he wants them to think. No, because they've got free will, they make choices on their own. And that's how God designed man and woman, right? Where they have the choices to make in their lives, whether or not they're going to be cursed or they're going to be blessed. God will see to it that your life will be blessed if you choose to do things his way. But look what it says there. It broke his heart. The very fact that they had gotten to a point, they were just constantly doing evil. It says consistently and doing things that were totally evil. And that's why God, he had to send forth the locusts. And this case, right, was the flood. But he had to send the locusts because of the fact that man had gotten too far with the wickedness that was in their heart. So look at that question there. What kind of devastation can the power of the locusts bring forth in people's lives? Well, look at number one here. It says, the power to destroy and what? Deplete all of a person's possessions and resources. What does it mean to deplete? Yeah, well, destroy or to zero out. Deplete means to make less and less and less. And let's face it, right? Sometimes this is the only way God can really get a person's attention. By what? Taking away their belongings. Isn't that true? For those of us who are parents, right? You just think about this, right? When a little kid, you know, misbehaves or doesn't listen to the parents, what does the parent say to the child? Okay, no more video games for you tonight, right? They'll take away, you know, the parent will take away something so that this is a form of discipline or punishment. And we got to understand, sometimes, you know, God, he has to do this, you know, because when we just continue to live our lives, just doing whatever we want and just, you know, saying, hey, there's no consequences, so I'm going to keep on doing it. Well, guess what? We're going to come to a point where destruction will come forth in our life. And that's why God, sometimes when he sends a locust, things will have to be taken away. And, you know, for those of us who complain and say, God, why do you do this? You know, the fact of the matter is, you know that God loves us. He loves you. He loves me. And sometimes, yeah, he has to do this as a parent, as a father, so that we will not continue on that path of destruction. I want you to look what it says here in Joel chapter 1, verses 1 to 7. And this clearly tells us that God, he wasn't fooling around. He had to take away everything, you know, from the Israelites. I want you to read this with me. Ready? Go. Hear this, you leaders of the people. Listen, all who live in the land. In all of your history, has anything like this happened before? Tell your children about it in the years to come, and let your children tell their children. Pass the story down from generation to generation. After the cutting locusts finished eating the crops, the swarming locusts took what was left. And after them came, and then the stripping locusts too. Wake up, you drunkards, and weep. Well, all you wine drinkers, all the grapes are ruined, and all your sweet wine is gone. A vast of army locusts has invaded my land, a terrible army, too numerous to count. Its teeth are like what? Lion's teeth, its fangs like those of a lioness. It has destroyed my grapevines and ruined my fig trees, stripping their bark and destroying it, leaving the branches white and bare. Despair, all you farmers. Wail, all you vine growers. Weep, because the wheat and the barley and all the crops of the field are ruined. The grapevines have dried up and the fig trees have withered. The pomegranate trees, the palm trees, the apple trees, all the fruit trees have dried up, and the people's joy has dried up with them. The day of the Lord is near, and the day when destruction comes from the Almighty. How terrible that day will be. Can you imagine? God, he sent all different kinds of locusts, the cutting locusts, the swarming locusts, the stripping locusts. You know, God had to make sure that pretty much everything would be taken away. Everything would be gone. And come on, we don't like to, you know, listen to a sermon where, you know, we hear about God taking everything away. But, you know, if you are a Christian that really knows and loves Jesus Christ, you realize, yeah, sometimes it is necessary that God, he has to discipline us. And one way that he will discipline us, when we've gone off track, when we've done things we know that have displeased him, you know, God, he will do what he needs to do. But the whole point of it is that he will get us back on track so that we will not experience, you know, the curses that the devil wants us to receive. And you think about this right now in the times we're living, is it all good? Would you say, we're all full of abundance, we're full of joy, love and peace, and I don't know what world you're living in, but right now there are wars going on. We're in a recession. You know, there's inflation, there's loss of jobs, loss of homes, loss of joy, loss of peace and prosperity. And we know the crime rate is sky high, right? But what are we going to do? Are we just going to cry about it? Are we going to say, God, you're not doing your job? Or are we going to say, Lord, I trust in you. And we're going to get down on our knees and we're going to pray to God, that God will keep us strong, that we will not lose our faith. Because we know God, he can do miracles, right? And we can trust that God, he will take care of us. Even though it seems like everything is falling apart, you know God, he's with us. Amen? And he promises us that he will take care of us, that he will never leave us, he will never forsake us. As long as we look to him, he will always be our provider. And I got to tell you, a lot of times I talk to people, right? They get very upset with God and they're blaming God for all the problems that are happening in the world and that are happening in their personal lives. And the thing is, right, a lot of people, when they experience hardship, you know, they tend to soften their hearts and they start looking to God. But you know what? For some people, their hearts get even harder, right? Because God may have depleted a lot of the resources that they once had. And they kind of go, wow, I got nothing. So why should I even trust in God anymore? Why should I even pray to him? And you know what? That's the last thing you want to do. The devil wants you to say, yeah, get away from the Lord. Don't trust in him anymore. No, you hang on to God even tighter. And I got to tell you, so many people, when they trust in the Lord, they see how God will come and restore, you know, whatever had been lost, God will bring forth in great abundance again. God's goodness will come forth once again. But it's sad, right? When you hear about people, they're getting farther away from God, right? When things get really, really tough. Look what it says there in Amos chapter 4, verses 9 to 10. Look what it says there. It says, I struck you with blight and mildew, your many gardens and your vineyards, your fig trees and your olive trees, the locusts devoured. Yet, what? You did not return to me, declares the Lord. And the Lord, he knew, right, that he had to take away all these things, right? And the olive trees, the locusts had all eaten up. But God says, hey, still, this all happened. You still didn't come back to me. Let me ask you, how do you think God felt when his children, right, knowing that they're supposed to be serving God, they're supposed to be loving God, instead of turning to him, they turned their backs on God? Do you think this grieved the Holy Spirit? You better believe it. This grieved God when he knew that his own children truly didn't really love him. You know, they really didn't want anything to do with God, especially when things didn't go their way. And that's why God, he had to follow through with his punishment of destruction in their lives, no matter how much it grieved him. But you got to understand, you know, God, he's waiting for a heart to turn back to him. A heart that is crying out to him. This is what pleases our Lord God. It's no matter how many times you blew it, you know, that doesn't matter what sin you committed. You can say, hey, I committed a terrible, terrible sin. No, God, when he sees that you have repented, that you're turning your heart back to him, God, he will come in and restore your life. Amen. And God, that's what he does. That's what his word tells us what he will do. And look what it says here in Jeremiah chapter 17, verses 9 to 10. I want you to read that with me. Ready? Go. The human heart is what? The most deceitful of all things and desperately wicked. Who really knows how bad it is? But I, the Lord, search all hearts and examine secret motives. I give all people their due rewards according to what? Their actions deserve, right? And it says the human heart is the what? Most deceitful of all things. Okay, you gotta understand, this is God who's saying this. And God, he created us all, right? And some people may ask, hey, God made us? So, hey, it's God's fault, right? That our heart is so deceitful and so wicked. Is it God's fault? Absolutely not. Because remember, like I said earlier, God has given us what? Free will. Because if he didn't give us free will, we'd be like robots. We wouldn't have a mind of our own. But you know, because we have free will, we think what we want to think. But you know what? We got to have control, right? Because if we are controlled by the Spirit of God, because you've been reading the Word of God, you've been praying to God, guess what? You're not going to have thoughts that will go off track, right? You're not going to have thoughts that will become more wicked if you don't fill your mind with the very words of God. And that's why, because it tells us, right, the human heart is most deceitful of all things and desperately wicked. Can you imagine? God is saying, that's why you need me. That's why you need my word. And that's what it says in verse 10. But I, the Lord, search all hearts and examine secret motives. I give all people their due rewards according to what? What their actions deserve. And guess what? If you're thinking the right thoughts, you're always, you know, making sure you're close to Jesus Christ, right? In spirit and in word and in truth. Guess what? You're not going to constantly go off track. You're going to stay where God wants you to be, and you're going to get so close to him. Amen? I want you to look at point number two now. It says here, these locusts, right, have the power to ultimately bring what? Great torment upon a person's life. And yeah, sometimes we got to understand, yeah, the locusts, their primary, I guess you could say their primary duty is to destroy all the vegetation, right? That's what they do. It's when, you know, they're sent in swarms, right? They will destroy everything inside because guess what? They're hungry. They want to eat what is of vegetation, right? What is of plant life. But you know what? In the book of Revelation, it tells us that one day the wickedness of man will grow to such great extremes that guess what? The locusts, they're not going to be focused on the plants and vegetation life anymore. You know what their focus is on? On human beings, right? On the very fact when people's hearts have turned totally cold, you know, against the Lord. They're just doing what is evil and wicked. You know, these locusts, they're going to bring great pain and torment to the people. And we're going to go, what? Really? These locusts, their primary focus is to bring forth torment. Look what it says here in Revelation 9, verses 1 to 6. Let's read it together. Ready? Go. Then the fifth angel blew his trumpet, and I saw a star that had fallen to earth from the sky, and he was given the key to the shaft of the bottomless pit. When he opened it, smoke poured out as though from a large furnace, and the sunlight and the air turned dark from the smoke. Look what it says in verse 3. It says, then locusts came from the smoke and descended on the earth, and they were given power to what? torment and sting like scorpions. They were told not to harm the grass or plants or trees, but only the people who did not have the seal of God on their foreheads. They were told not to kill them, but to torture them for 5 months with pain like the pain of a scorpion sting. And in those days, people will seek death, but they will not find it. They will long to die, but death will flee from them. And you know, hopefully we will never get to experience or give witness to these evil creatures, right? Coming to our area and inflicting pain and torment upon the people. Because that's what it tells us. There's going to come a day when the wickedness of man will grow in such great extremes that God will send the swarm of locusts to torment man directly. Okay? That's what it tells us. Yet, you know what? We don't need these kinds of creatures in our world to create pain and suffering in our lives. Do we still have pain and suffering in this world that we live in? Yeah, sometimes there's pestilence, there's disease, whatever it may be, right? And, you know, especially when people's hearts have grown cold towards God, right? God will allow these things to happen. You know, God, we're going to do whatever he can do to get our attention back on him. And sometimes this is necessary. But you know what? You got to understand, God promises to turn it all around when people turn their hearts back to him. This is what God is waiting for. And sometimes this is the only way, right? It's through suffering that people will realize, hey, I need God. I need Jesus. And as much as we don't want this, because who likes to suffer? Raise your hand if you love to suffer. Oh, come on. Nobody wants to suffer, right? But as a Christian, I got to tell you, I've been a Christian. I've been walking with the Lord for 30, almost 40 years. And you can tell you how old I am, right? I'm almost 60. But, you know, the fact of the matter is, right, I can tell you, I don't like suffering. But in those times of suffering, that's when I've drawn closest to God. It's when those days, right, when I kind of felt like, man, what's the sense of living? I mean, it got to a point where you just want to give up. But then you feel the experience, feel the presence of God. You know he's there and he's helping you through it. I mean, those were the days where I felt strengthened by the Lord and it increased my faith. And know that God, he can do that if you hang on to him, if you trust in him. Amen. But we got to realize that God, he can easily turn things around. And he did this for the Israelites. I want you to look what it says here in Exodus chapter 15, verse 26. I want you to read this with me. Ready? Go. He said, if you will listen carefully to the voice of the Lord your God and do what is what? Right in his sight, obeying his commands and keeping all his decrees, then I will not make you suffer any of the diseases I sent on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord who what? Who heals you. And as God's people, he heals us. We can count on that because he tells us this in his word. No matter what disease you're facing right now, you got to have the faith to believe that God can heal you. Can you just say that with me right now, that God is my healer? Can we say that together? Ready? Go. God is my healer. And there is nothing impossible for him. And, you know, some people say, oh, I prayed and God never answered my prayer. So are you just going to give up then? No, you keep on praying because God wants to know if your faith is really real. Because a person's faith who is not really real, they pray a couple times and go, God's not listening. Yeah, forget God. No, God wants you to keep on praying, keep on trusting. Because as you do, guess what? Your heart will grow stronger and bigger for him. And you're going to realize that God will not let me down. And I got to tell you, all the times in my life, right, when I knew I kept on praying to God, and it seems like, you know, there were times, you know, God answered right away, right? Immediate, almost like, wow, just in like just that day, I saw that miracle happen. But there were other days, other times, where it just, like, I had to wait. And it got to a point where I go, God, are you listening? Are you still, you know, working in my life? But, you know, when I look back all those times in my life, I realize God answered every single one of my prayers. Sometimes it took a little longer because God was working on my heart. He was working on my spirit. He wanted me to draw closer to Him. That's why He wanted me to wait. So no matter what, keep on trusting. If you wait upon the Lord, the Bible says He will renew your strength. And you're going to mount on as wings as eagles. And you're going to have the strength to keep going forward strong with the Lord if you keep your eyes on Jesus. Amen? I want you to look at point number three now. It says here, the power of the locust will sometimes cause a person to what? To choose God and be restored back unto Him. And that's what we realize, right? When we know for a fact, when God, you know, sends these swarm of locusts into a person's life, you know, for some people, they're going to feel like they hit rock bottom, right? And sometimes, because everything is taken away, it seems like nothing is going, you know, as they want to, you know, as they want it in their lives. Guess what? They turn to God for help. And that is good, right? When your heart is wanting God to intervene. But, you know, for some people, they choose to go the other direction. But for those who head towards God, right, you got a choice. When things don't go your way, are you going to run to God or are you going to run away from God? You got to run to God, right? And because, you know, sometimes when people, you know, realize they hit rock bottom, they got nowhere to go. Because when you hit rock bottom, it means that is the very bottom of the bottom, right? And sometimes you hit it so hard, man, you're hurting. But you realize, I heard one pastor say this, when you hit rock bottom, guess who you meet? Because the Bible says, who is the rock? Jesus is the rock, right? When you hit rock bottom, Jesus is right there. And it's up to you. Are you going to hold on to Jesus? Are you going to embrace Jesus? Because sometimes when we hit rock bottom, the only place you got to look now is what? It's got to look up. You got nowhere to go. And if you start looking up to Jesus, that's where God, He's going to say, okay, I'm here for you, child. I'm going to help you. But you got to make sure your heart is totally surrendered to Him. Look what it says here in Joel chapter 2. Verses 1 to 2. Let's read it together. Ready? Go. Sound the trumpet in Jerusalem. Raise the alarm on my holy mountain. Let everyone tremble in fear because the day of the Lord is upon us. It is a day of dark and gloom, a day of thick clouds and deep blackness. Suddenly, like dawn spreading across the mountains, a great and mighty army appears. Nothing like it has been seen before or will ever be seen again. Okay, look what it says here. Joel, he says to sound a trumpet, right? To warn everyone, right? Because the fact is, the very terrible things that God said He will bring forth will come. Because they've been warned time and time and again, right? But they have not responded to the Lord. And in fact, they have turned away from the Lord. But look what it says there. Let everyone tremble in what? In fear. Let me ask you, is it a good thing that sometimes we experience fear? Well, you know what? Sometimes we need to be in fearful situations to realize how much we need the Lord. And sometimes there is nothing better than a good dose of fear to set a person straight back into the things of God. And I gotta tell you, right? Some people say, oh, isn't fear something that we should not experience as children of the Lord? Well, what does the Bible say? The Bible says the fear of the Lord is what? The beginning of wisdom. In other words, that's when you get really smart, right? When you realize, man, you know, things aren't going my way and it seems like, you know, the Lord is trying to get my attention. You know what? I'm going to turn to God. And so, you know, sometimes we need that fear, the fear of the Lord, realizing, you know, God, He will not let us get away with sin. He loves us too much to say, yeah, it's okay. I know you're doing this terrible sin, but hey, I'm going to let you go. Well, God will not do that because he knows this sin can destroy your life if you think you can get away with it every single time, right? And so God says, no, I'm not going to let that happen. And so when we have this fear of the Lord, right, and we turn back to God, that I got to tell you, the Lord is so delighted to see a child of his repenting and returning back to him. And when this person does this, right, when this person repents and turns to the Lord, this is what God promises. I want you to look what it says here in Joel chapter 2, verses 25 to 27. I want you to read this with me. Ready? Go. The Lord says, I will give you back what you lost to the swarming locust, the hopping locust, the stripping locust, and the cutting locust. It was I who sent this great destroying army against you. Once again, you will have all the food you want, and you will praise the Lord your God who does these miracles for you. Never again will my people be disgraced. Then you will know that I am among my people Israel, that I am the Lord your God, and there is no other. Never again will my people be disgraced. Wow. And we realize, right, God says, I'm going to restore everything back to you. All the locusts that had come to destroy everything in sight, right? God says, I'm going to return everything back. I'm going to restore everything back to you. And if you know you have gotten to that point where you know that you have strayed from God, and it seems like, yeah, things have been depleted from your life, know that God can restore it, right? You got to get your mind, your heart back on Jesus. This is what God is waiting for. And guess what? God is waiting for you to do this, okay? And if you know that your heart is being tugged in that direction, this is the Holy Spirit that is counseling you. He's telling you, it's about time, child, you get back with the Lord. Don't resist. Don't fight. Go back to Jesus. And you're going to see how your life will be so blessed by him once again. I want you to take a look at the bottom line verse now. And this is in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. I'm sure you're familiar with this verse because a lot of pastors use this verse in their sermons, okay? Read it with me. Ready? Go. Yeah. Then if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sins, and I will restore their land. Wow. If you are God's people, right, you know in your heart that you belong to Jesus. And it takes us to humble ourselves, because sometimes, you know what, we let pride get in the way. We tell ourselves, oh, you know what? I don't need God anymore. I can handle this on my own. I hear people tell me this, right? And do you think their situation gets better? No, it gets worse. And they get deeper and deeper into the pit, and they kind of wonder, why aren't things getting better? Well, guess what? God is waiting for you to turn your heart back to him. And he says, if my people will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, he will hear from heaven and he will forgive their sins, and God will restore the land that the locusts had destroyed. God says, I'm going to renew it. I'm going to restore it. I'm going to rebuild it. I'm going to make it so it's even better than what it once was. And we realize the key word here is repent. God wants your heart to be fully devoted to him. And you know, it doesn't matter, you know, how long it's been. You can say, Pastor Ben, but it's been so long. I strayed from the Lord, and I've been so upset at God. And, you know, I don't think God would want me anymore. Sometimes I hear people say that. I say, doesn't matter how long. As long as you're willing today to just soften your heart, even just a little bit, and say, God, I want you to enter back into my life. I need you. I want you to come into my life once again and show me how to live. God, he's going to be so happy. He's going to be so pleased to hear that from you, to hear that from me, right? If we've strayed, God wants you to come back. on track with him. You know, I got to tell you, many years ago, there was this elderly man from Kansas City. His name was Al Johnson, and he came to a saving faith in Jesus Christ. You know, after listening to a pastor's sermon in church, you know, the Holy Spirit convicted him of a crime that he committed as a teenager. I mean, years ago, okay? And apparently at the age of 19, he participated in a bank robbery with his buddies. And, you know, in his heart, he believed, right? Because he had a relationship with Jesus Christ now. He knew in his heart, you know, that he had to confess of his sins. And he wanted to make things right. So you know what he did? He went to the police station and he turned himself in. And he told them, he says, I committed this crime like probably like 40 something years ago, but I want to come clean. I don't want to let this hang in my mind and in my heart anymore. Well, you know, the police heard what he had to say, but because of the statute of limitations on the case, you guys know what that is, right? They had run out, which meant that he no longer could be prosecuted for the offense, okay? But, you know, in his mind and in his heart, he still felt that he needed to do something. So you know what? He felt like he had to do the next best thing. And he knew that this is what God would want him to do. And let me ask you, do you think God would say, okay, no more of these swarm of locusts in your life anymore? Because God saw that his heart was genuine. So what do you think God will bring forth now in his life? Wow, the goodness of the Lord will be upon his life. Remember, God wants to know if you are genuine about your repentance. Because it's so easy to say, yeah, Lord, I'm sorry. I'm not going to do it anymore. But then guess what? We walk out the door and we just repeat that sin over and over. But when God knows that your heart is truly sincere, truly genuine, you're going to do whatever you can to make things right with him. And when you do so, I'm going to tell you, the Bible talks about showers of blessings coming forth in your life. Just be prepared that God will shower your life with an abundance of his blessings when he sees that your heart truly belongs to him. Amen? Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Why don't we go ahead? Let's bow our heads. Let's bow our hearts. Let's come before our Father in heaven. Father God, we just want to thank you, Lord, for this message spoken today. And Father, you know, sometimes we don't want to listen to a message that talks about death and destruction. But we know, as believers, you know, we know you are our Father God. And sometimes you have to discipline us in ways that will draw our hearts back to you. And for those of us who really understand this, We know when suffering comes, when hardship comes, we're going to look to Jesus Christ. And Father, even when the locusts, the swarm of locusts have to come, we're going to hang on to God. We're going to hang on to Jesus ever so tightly, and we're not letting go. And we know when these locusts have left and we have been restored unto God because we now have repented and we look to Jesus, we know the goodness of God will come forth in such great measure as we totally entrust our lives to you. And right now, with all our heads bowed, with our eyes closed, you may be saying, you know, Pastor Ben, if I were to be honest with you, I can see that, you know, right now in my life, I have strayed from God, if I were to be totally honest. But now I have listened to this message, and I just felt like the Holy Spirit speaking to my heart. And I feel like I don't want to run anymore from God. I want to run to him. I don't want to run away from him anymore. And I know even as the locusts have come, I know God, he can restore my life once again. And he will bring his goodness in my life if I trust in him. And if this is the cry of your heart, you're saying, Lord, forgive me of this time that I have strayed from you. I'm running to you with all of my heart right now, and I want your goodness to abound in my life. If this is the cry of your heart right now, can you just raise your hand and say, that's me, Lord. Praise God. Anyone else saying, Jesus, that is my heart, And I'm running to you with everything I am, everything I have, everything I got. Praise God. Anyone else? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. All right. You can put your hands down. Let's pray. Father, you've seen all the hands that were raised, but most importantly, it's the hearts behind those hands saying, Lord, I need you. Lord, I want my life to be fully in your hands once again. Father, I pray that restoration will come. Father, I pray right now in the name of Jesus Christ that your blessings will overflow in their lives. I pray that miracles will start to happen in their lives where they're going to know it's only by the power of God that these things can happen. And I pray, Father, that as my brothers and sisters realize this, they will never, ever turn from you. Again, Father, their hearts will even grow stronger, grow even more in total submission to you as they realize your love is so real that you truly see us as your children and that you're always going to take care of us throughout our lives and throughout eternity. And Father, we just want to praise you for that. And we give you glory, honor, and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Now, for some of you, you may be saying, you know, Pastor Ben, you know, I just heard the word of God and I know I haven't given my life to Jesus. And you may be saying, you know, I know I've been procrastinating. I keep on saying, oh, maybe not today, maybe tomorrow, maybe next week, next month, next year. Well, why would you want to wait? Jesus wants to bless you today, but your life has to be in his hands. You got to say yes to Jesus before Father God can take a hold of your life and bless your life. And right now, once again, with our heads bowed, with our eyes closed, you're saying, I want to say yes to Jesus. I want him to be the Lord and Savior of my life. I want to surrender all that I am to Jesus Christ. And if this is the cry of your heart right now, can you just raise your hand and say, yes, Lord, I'm saying yes to you with all of my heart. Praise God. Praise God. Anyone else saying yes to Jesus? Yes to Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. All right. You can put your hands down. Praise God. Praise God. I want you to pray this prayer with me. And, you know, if you raise your hand, please pray this from your heart. I can guarantee you God is listening right now. But let's pray it all together as a family, whether you have received him or not. The very fact is God, he who wants your heart right now. So why don't we pray this prayer together? Just repeat after me. Say, Father God, I need you. I give you praise for who you are. I believe in you. I believe in your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for me on the cross. But on the third day, he rose again, and he lives inside of my heart. I give you praise for that. And Father God, I confess that I'm a sinner. But your word says, if I confess of my sins, you are faithful and just to forgive me of my sins and cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Cleanse me now, Lord, and make me holy and pure unto you. So now I say this so you can hear me, Father God, so everyone can hear me, so I can hear myself, and so that the devil will know that Jesus Christ is my Lord. I live for him. I live for him only. Father God, I thank you for you have written my name in your Lamb's Book of Life, and I'll spend eternity with you forever. It's in Jesus' name I pray. And everyone says, amen. Let's give him a clap offering. Praise God. Hallelujah.